So I have been recently taking lots of crap regarding this phrase, data is the new oil, or DITNO, as I've been informed. People are telling me this statement is old, outdated, not relevant. But let me explain to you why I think this phrase is as relevant, if not more so than ever. The reason why I love this statement, data is a new oil, that really came out probably 7 or so years ago, there are two reasons. Number one, for the first time in my long history in this industry, 40 years being involved in data and analytics industry, for the first time, somebody has associated something of value with data, right? For the longest time, data was a cost minimized. For much of my past 40 years, we used very expensive relational database management systems on even more expensive scale-up compute and storage platforms. And as a result, because it was so darn expensive, we aggregated data, we sampled data. We only kept 24 months of aggregated data, right? Data was a cost to minimize. Data was primarily used for management reporting and regulatory reporting. It wasn't really used to drive the business as much as it was used to monitor the business. And then 7 or so years ago, Hadoop comes out. Driven by Google and commercialized by Yahoo, Hadoop brought an open source data management software that ran on commodity processors for storage and processing for compute and storage, and it changed the economics of data. It introduced the era of big data, where now we had this ability to look at huge volumes, petabytes of volume, at a reasonable economic cost. And when that happened, it really unleashed the economics of big data. So number one, there was this association with data had value, and it wasn't necessarily a cost to minimize. So that was the first thing, and that's a good thing. And in itself, that's a good thing. But the real impact of this statement is this. In the same way that oil was the fuel that drove the economic growth in the 20th century, data will be the catalyst that drives the economic growth in the 21st century. The data is no longer a technology byproduct, the exhaust of the business that we try to minimize. No, in many cases, data is the business. And in more and more industries, we're seeing data becoming an integral part of the business, if not in some cases, it becoming the business. In fact, we're starting to see this already. If you look at the top market cap companies, you can see how these companies who are the masters of data monetization, the Apples, the Googles, the Microsofts, how the very sources of economic value are changing. And that change is accelerating, right? No longer is a company's value being defined by tangible assets as it was during the era of oil, when you had ExxonMobil and Schmarzo and Chevron and these companies, these oil companies defining value, where possession of the asset, in this case, oil, defined their value. No, we're now seeing this shift to intangible assets. And more the intangible assets are around data and how data is being used by analytics to create new customer product and operational insights. By the way, I want to give you a hint. We saw this transition starting to occur right around 2002. Hint, who did Google hire in 2002 that was an instrumental part in changing their business model? Hal Varian, who, by the way, was their chief economist, not their chief data scientist, not their chief technology dude. No, the person who helped drive the transformation of the Google business model was an economist. So we're seeing hints already as early as 2002 that the conversation shouldn't be around technology. It should be around economics and how data is an economic asset, not some technology byproduct or exhaust to be minimized, which brings forth this concept that I call nanoeconomics. I'm championing this concept of nanoeconomics. We've got macroeconomics and we got microeconomics. Now I'm introducing this concept of nanoeconomics. And nanoeconomics is the economic theory of the individual predicted propensity of the individual, either human or device, right? Is our ability to predict propensities, tendencies, even relationships, right? To use that information to be able to create predicted propensities on every person, whether they're a patient, a doctor, a nurse, a student, a technician, a barista, right? Or devices like wind turbines and chillers and compressors and clutches, right? We have the ability to leverage nanoeconomics to create these predicted propensities at the individual level. And we're capturing those predicted propensities in what I call analytic profiles, or some folks call them asset models. It is around these analytic profiles that we're capturing all these different propensities, and we're using these to drive our use cases. Let me give you a real world example. When I was at Yahoo, we had 500 million visitors who came to our site, and we built an analytic profile on each and every one of them. We knew what sites they'd gone to. We knew what ads they clicked on. We knew what keywords they put in, right? We knew their whole pattern of journey across the internet and what websites they went to, and what ads they clicked on, but also what ads they didn't click on. And we created these very detailed profiles to figure out what they might be interested in, because we had a fraction of a second when they came to one of the sites, and we managed to figure out what ad to show them and where to put that ad. How do we do that? We build analytic profiles, right? We store them in the cookies. So then we came to our sites, we knew exactly what we thought you were interested in, so we could serve the right ad at the right time to the right person. And this all builds towards the Schmarzo economic digital asset valuation theorem. Yes, my very overt attempt to win a Nobel Prize in treating data as an economic asset. And when you start mastering data as an economic asset, and you start mastering the ability to reuse and refine these data and analytic assets, that never wear out, never deplete, that can be used across an infinite number of use cases at zero marginal cost. And in many cases, if you engineer them correctly, if you curate them correctly, you can create these assets that the more they use, the more value they become, right? They don't depreciate in value as they're used. They actually appreciate because they get more reliable, more predictive, more valuable. And it's being driven by some very important economic axioms around the marginal propensity to consume, the marginal propensity to reuse, the marginal propensity to continuously learn. So as we're thinking about this, this comment about data is the new oil. It's as relevant as ever. Yeah, it may be kind of cheesy. It may be old in some people's eyes, but I'm going to tell you right now, I think it's critical. It's critical for organizations to understand that data is a unique economic asset, unlike anything we've ever seen in our life. And there's a small set of companies out there who are mastering this, right? It's the digital marketing companies. It's the social media companies. It's the e-commerce companies. And more it's financial services. And we're starting to see more and more of these companies realize, wait a second. This isn't about technology. It's about economics. It's about the creation and distribution of wealth and value. So I get back to my original point. Data is the new oil. And it's the same way that oil was the fuel that drove the economic growth in the 20th century, I believe that data, and many people believe that data, will be the catalyst that drives the economic growth in the 21st century. Thanks for your time. Cheers.